Well, welcome everybody. Thanks for being here. It's a very lovely crowd and I appreciate everyone's interest in coming out here tonight. It was nice to meet some of you for the first time and to see you again here if I know you from previous meetings. This is our 2016 State of the City, where we're going to give you an update on things that we've accomplished in the past year, and also I'm going to propose some recommendations for what I think we should be doing into the future. But before we show you a video overview of what we've done in the past year, I do want to thank some folks. First of all, I want to thank the library for hosting us here this evening. We have a beautiful asset here in this library, and the community room here is especially intended for functions like this. We're very happy that they were able to host us here tonight. I want to thank members of the council who are here. We have several in attendance. We have Councilmember Martin Brubaker in the back there, Marty, Councilmember Alshire, and Councilmember Munson, and I think that's it. So we do have a majority of the council here. Technically, this is an open meeting. It was advertised as such, so we're not going to be discussing any official business tonight. But certainly, we will have questions, time for questions at the end. I know some people have some questions, so I'll be glad to stick around until everyone has their questions answered. So 2015, several other people I need to thank and recognize. We have many, many staff here today who really make us all look good, all of us elected officials, and I wanted to recognize them for all the hard work that they do in making us look so good. First, we have our communications manager, Aaron Wolf, and Eric Hastings. I don't know what his official title is. He's just our official tech guru, all things audio video. We have with us our Director of Customer Service and Information Technology, Scott Nicewarner, is also with us here tonight. And let's see, who else am I missing? I know we have our city administrator too, and I wanted to introduce Valerie Means. This is her first State of the City with us, and I wanted to thank her for all of her hard work in this first year. We had Bruce Zimmerman as our city administrator for over 20 years, and I personally want to thank him again for all of his service and commitment to the city of Hagerstown. It has been an exciting year, not without its challenges. Certainly, the turnover in the top leadership of City Hall has created some challenges, but many, many more opportunities. And I'm very proud of the staff and all of our city workers for all the work that they do. Okay, so let's roll the videotape, show you what we've been doing in 2015.
Downtown Hagerstown is definitely more lively than any part of Hagerstown.
There's a really eclectic community here, and definitely a lot between like the interior design shops, between the thrift stores, between the different restaurants. There's something for everybody here.
I really like that there are a lot of restaurants, so it's different picks for what we want to eat. I think that's pretty cool.
I think one thing that gives me hope for our community's future is the active interest that everybody has in the community. People want to have a community garden. They want to have a clean city. They want to have murals.
I like going to school in downtown Hagerstown because we have the library where we go to for some of our classes sometimes.
I believe in downtown Hagerstown because of all the great changes we've seen in the last 7 years, the private-public partnerships, the great people that are making it happen, like the downtown movement, and we're only going to be greater tomorrow.
We are on the path to a new Hagerstown, a process that includes renewing our downtown, reclaiming our neighborhoods, redeveloping business, and rebuilding our community spirit. We're implementing the community's city center plan, a 10-year roadmap to lead downtown development through 8 catalyst projects. We received significant community input in the development of this plan, and we continue to gain feedback as we carry out these projects with our partners. This year, we have seen renewed commitments from our businesses, faith communities, our neighbors, and countless dedicated volunteers who want to see a new Hagerstown. Here's how we work together to make progress in our city in 2015.
Progress is best achieved collaboratively and cooperatively. That's why we've enhanced our efforts to get our residents and businesses more directly involved in our planning and decision processes.
The city has grown participation and actionable outcomes through community engagement initiatives under the Engage Hagerstown brand. For the last 2 years, we've facilitated the Engage Hagerstown website, which provides an online format for productive discussion and feedback with city staff. In 2015, the website's platform was transitioned to a model that is more user-friendly. The site is currently being used to get feedback for updates to the city's comprehensive plan. It also proved valuable in gaining ideas in the search for the next police chief. And we heard about concepts for features and public art along the trail that will connect City Park and the Arts and Entertainment District.
Outreach on all of our engagement platforms has seen increased traffic, indication there's greater interest and greater participation in moving our city forward.
To increase the range of feedback, the city explored input from both online and in-person opportunities. We've moved beyond the traditional town hall-style public meeting format. We're encouraging interactive participation and directed discussion in focus groups.
Participation was encouraging when it came to discussing an expansion of the city's farmers market. Those ideas were incorporated into a request for proposals, which will help identify a private operator for the market.
Community meetings were also held to brainstorm potential uses for city-owned property. And in 2015, the city received a parcel of land in the West End, which will be developed into a pocket park. The neighborhood was invited to a meeting where they could share ideas for the park. Then they were invited back to pick their park, based on concepts that were developed by a landscape architect with the community's ideas. The city is keeping the community more engaged by keeping you informed. Mayor and council meetings and minutes are easily accessed from the city's website, and you can now watch meetings live on our YouTube channel.
The City of Hagerstown supports a shared vision for housing and neighborhoods, one that upholds community standards and promotes clean, safe, and strong neighborhoods.
We are strengthening neighborhoods by supporting more opportunities for home ownership, which is also part of the community's city center plan. In 2015, 11 home buyers participated with the citywide down payment and rehab program. Buyers received up to $7,500 if they purchased a home that was built before 1964 and had been vacant for a year or more. 5 home buyers participated in the City Center Residency Initiative, which offered up to $10,000 for down payment or rehab costs within a designated area of the downtown. Through both programs, the loan is forgiven if the home is the principal residence for 5 years or more. One arm of the City Center Residency Initiative also supports residents who rent their homes, offering a subsidy of up to $300 per month in target areas. 10 renters participated in 2015. Qualified applicants in each of these incentive programs includes college students and graduates, government employees, military members, working professionals, and more. These living incentives have proven to be so successful that funding is exhausted and the city is pursuing funding sources for the future of these programs.
The city is setting an example for developers and investors through our Artists Loft project, where artists live and create in loft apartments while supporting a cooperative gallery on the first floor. Engine Room Art Space opened in 2015. It's a place where local emerging artists can display their work while providing an opportunity for the community to discover new expressions of art.
In 2015, the City of Hagerstown used state and federal funds to purchase 3 vacant rental properties, 2 along South Prospect Street and 1 along East Franklin Street. The goal is to renovate the buildings and sell them through the city's homeownership program to support our neighborhoods.
Changes to the city's vacant structures and rental licensing programs also protect the quality of life in our neighborhoods by addressing blighting influences. Code staff has inventoried and now monitors vacant properties across the city. There are now measures in place to resolve situations with habitual offenders who have recurring violations and police calls for service. Staff from code, fire, and police all support the operations of these programs.
Our neighbors continue to show why they love city life. Through the city's Neighborhoods First program, groups are organizing their own events to build community pride.
City engineers are providing a safer trip for students who walk to and from Bester Elementary, thanks to a Safe Routes to School grant from the Maryland State Highway Administration that fully funds the project. The plan includes building multi-use paths and upgrading pedestrian signals.
The Hagerstown Fire Department remains committed to their smoke detector program, providing free smoke alarms to city residents who apply. Through a partnership with Home Depot, firefighters accepted 100 smoke detectors to build up their inventory.
Neighborhood policing continues to be a vital part of operations for the Hagerstown Police Department. The department is able to hire 4 new officers thanks to a grant from a Federal Community-Oriented Policing Services, or COPS grant. These officers will focus on using technology and engaging residents to prevent crime in designated city neighborhoods. This brings the force to 112 officers strong. Body-worn cameras are a new tool for our officers, enhancing transparency of their work and building trust with the community. 6 cameras are being used in the pilot of this program, and additional cameras will be deployed as funding allows. Generally speaking, the cameras will be used when an officer is called to respond to an incident. The use of these cameras in other communities has shown to decrease officers' use of force, as well as complaints against officers.
The City of Hagerstown works to help start, expand, and nurture business opportunities across the community. City Center continues to be the most highly incentivized area for development in all of Washington County. The city is moving on state legislation that would make Hagerstown a pilot community for a Community Revitalization and Improvement Zone, or CRIZ, a bipartisan, solutions-oriented approach to new development. This incentive program would capture new tax revenue to help the investor pay the debt service in the project's early years.
The City of Hagerstown will become a gigabit city. We support innovation and recognize the importance of affordable, reliable, high-speed internet service to our community. The city became a member in the Next Century Cities organization, joining communities across the nation that share common principles for accessible broadband. Antietam Cable stepped forward to partner with the city to bring 1 gig broadband service to an area of about 8 blocks surrounding the city center, providing a resource that will advance economic development opportunities in our core.
Main Street Hagerstown is helping volunteers work collaboratively to create visible, impactful change in our downtown. Organized among 5 work groups, projects in 2015 have brought recycling bins to our Main Street sidewalks, encouraged investors to imagine the possibilities in empty buildings, and created opportunities for friends and families to enjoy City Center Hagerstown through Second Saturday events. Hagerstown's success with our incentive programs has drawn interest from our partners at the state, who are eager to support future projects.
2015 saw the first student housing project come to fruition. The city and the University System of Maryland at Hagerstown partnered with a private developer to create 4 apartments, each with 2 bedrooms and 2 bathrooms to house 8 students. The building along North Potomac Street was previously a 19-room boarding house. The renovation transformation was completed in just 4 months. The project is part of the Community City Center Plan, which supports the expansion of USMH.
The mayor and council also gave the green light to move forward with a project that could lead to the construction of new Class A office space on the central parking lot in City Center, another catalyst project. Bowman Development competitively applied to be considered. They're working with the city now to complete a site analysis and develop a cost outline.
The city has purchased stagnant vacant property with a goal of making visible changes and removing barriers to development. Improvements were made to the building at 170 West Washington Street, replacing the roof, windows, front porch, and repainting the exterior. The project was funded largely by state community legacy funds.
The city supported the new library and the surrounding neighborhood by tearing down some dilapidated properties. Washington County government sold the Massey property to the city for $1. In turn, the city demolished 2 buildings and is now maintaining the old Massey showroom. These properties and others are listed for sale through the competitive negotiated sale process, a method that ensures property is responsibly returned to the private sector for development that will have a more positive impact on the community.
Thanks to an investment from Pinnacle Foods, more than 100 jobs are coming to Hagerstown in the future. The Fortune 1000 company purchased the former Unilever plant located off Frederick Street. The city, the county, and the state of Maryland provided a competitive incentive package to draw the business to Hagerstown in the midst of their national search. The city of Hagerstown is a progressive, financially responsible community. We maintain our facilities and infrastructure to ensure smooth, continuous operations. We provide services within the scope of our available resources in response to the needs of our community.
Our community is now a sustainable Maryland certified community. The city was recognized at the state level for our efforts to go green, save money, and sustain our quality of life for the future. The designation signifies the city as one of the leading municipalities in Maryland.
The mayor and council resolved to enhance fitness and healthy eating in our community through initiatives developed by the statewide HEAL program. New recreation programs were offered to promote active lifestyles such as dance classes, cycling, and outdoor wiffle ball, kickball, and dodgeball leagues.
Residents are getting a healthier perspective on their plates with the new community garden along South Potomac Street. The project became a reality after members of the Community Garden Task Force researched options and brought a plan to mayor and council. The individual plots can be rented annually at a cost of $20 to $30.
The mayor and council continues to address a long-standing blight on the community, the old melt plant. This administration reached a settlement in which the owner would demolish the structure and transfer the property back to the city. The owner has defaulted on the agreement. Now the city is determining the best path forward to complete the demolition as quickly as possible while reaching a responsible resolution for the best interest of the community.
We're taking a more comprehensive look at our city streets and making room for all forms of transportation. Mayor and Council adopted a livable streets policy and design guidelines. The process ensures safe and comfortable use for vehicles, cyclists, pedestrians, and others on public streets. The change encourages people to integrate physical activity into their daily lives while improving public health, reducing traffic congestion, and supporting economic development.
The city is working with our partners at the county, state, and regional level to address pedestrian safety along Dole Highway. Together, we engaged the community to determine target areas and identify solutions to recurring problems. The State Highway Administration will now implement the strategies identified through those findings.
The Finance Department is receiving national attention for its transparency in showing the community how it balances the budget. Staff was recognized with a Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting, the highest recognition in governmental accounting, through the Government Finance Officers Association.
Finance staff is overseeing the bond financing to maintain our infrastructure, ensuring our residents receive services consistently and at reasonable rates. The city, along with other surrounding municipalities, implemented a new water treatment process to maintain federal drinking water standards. This provides a higher quality drinking water because it lasts longer in the system and there are fewer taste and odor concerns that are typically associated with chlorine.
The City of Hagerstown supports a high quality of life in our neighborhoods, business districts, and community gathering places. We're making enhancements to make our city more livable and active. We celebrated 20 years of the Western Maryland Blues Fest and Augustoberfest in City Center in Hagerstown.
Through action items in the community's City Center plan, the city seeks to expand community events, offering more ways for our downtown to be a place for friends and family to enjoy entertainment, culture, and the arts. The city supports private groups who have used the downtown to host their events, bringing significant foot traffic to the city center and supporting our small businesses.
The City of Hagerstown owns and manages 19 parks throughout the community. In 2015, we opened 4 new parks.
We're leveraging grant funding to add amenities in our parks and public facilities. Take a look at the enhancements we made with the state's program Open Space Funding.
Memorial Park serves as an outdoor classroom with trail markers that tell Hagerstown's history. The Circle of Achievement features Hagerstown's most notable citizens who made impacts in our community and beyond the city's borders. 12 inductees were included in the first class. As part of the celebration, their descendants unveiled a tributary plaque in their honor. The grandson of Jacob Wheaton attended. Jacob was the first African American to vote in Maryland after the Civil War. And the great-great-great-great-great-granddaughter of our city's founder was also part of the celebration.
We're making strides in improving City Park Lake. Mayor and Council approved a proposal for a consultant to examine the many aspects involving a dredging project. Dredging the bottom of the lake will improve the quality of water, in turn creating opportunities for expanded use of the lake and a better environment for the fish and waterfowl.
The city invests in the youth of our community through the support of summer camps across the city. Mayor and Council approves funding each year for summer programs at Girls Inc., the Hagerstown YMCA, and the Robert W. Johnson Community Center. Nearly 300 kids in Hagerstown participate in the camps over the summer.
Baseball celebrated its century anniversary in 2015. The first organized baseball game was played on May 28, 1915, when the Hagerstown Blues played their first home game at what was known as Willow Lane Park, now the site of Bester Elementary School. 2015 also marks the 35th anniversary season for the Hagerstown Suns in the Hub City. The city of Hagerstown continues to explore options for keeping professional minor league baseball in our community.
Moving forward, we invite you to be a part of the reinvention of Hagerstown. Let's understand our past, but let's not be sentimental or fearful of change. Let's invest our time, energy, and talents in our future. Be engaged in what's happening in our city. Share your ideas, work with your neighbors. Let's be bold and see our shared vision become a reality. That wonderful production. And you might have sensed a theme of really partnerships and leading by example in that presentation. And I think what I believe is happening when we look at the arc of history in Hagerstown is I really don't think we've been in a time where we've had more hopefulness and engagement in the community. And I think that's where we're at. We have a vision, a shared vision for what we want this community to look like in the future. And that's really as a result of, first of all, the effort we undertook with Urban Partners over 2 years ago now. And we promised that that plan would not collect dust on a shelf. And we are certainly moving forward on all fronts with that plan to really bring to fruition this shared vision that we have. So like I said at the end of the video there, let's be bold. Let's take action and do these things and get it done. I said this morning, and I'll say it again, I like to call this our 2020 vision. And you could look at that in, you know, with its intended double meaning. You know, we have to have the resolving power of an eagle and stay focused with 2020 vision on what we want to do and what we want to accomplish, where we want to go. And we can do this in the next 4 years. This is low-hanging fruit that by the year 2020, we can really see a lot of these things come to fruition. So I am encouraged, you know, as a result of the state of the county, that the county is now, looks like they're being prepared to be more supportive of our efforts at economic revitalization here in Hagerstown. They announced that they're going to be working with the city and the Board of Education to move forward with the academic building combined with expansion of the Maryland Theater. So what that means for the city is that that's two or three catalyst projects that we can check off on the list of things that we're trying to accomplish. One of those is, of course, the expansion of the Maryland Theater and the expansion of our educational footprint in downtown, which is present in the Barbara Ingram School for the Arts, but also with the University System of Maryland at Hagerstown. So, you know, creating that academic learning space, whether it's in the form of a classroom or a dance studio or a science lab, those are great assets to have, and we should encourage and facilitate the new construction of these facilities in our city center. We have plans for new office buildings and also the rehab of old office buildings. I do not think it has to be an either-or proposition. In fact, if we had more Class A office space in downtown, it would in fact make our other levels of office space even more attractive to potential developers and tenants. I think we are making progress and moving forward with the Art Link, as I like to call it, the Hagerstown Cultural Trail. The City Council just earlier this evening gave final approval for the ordinances to move forward with that project. And I think the key there is that we're investing in the infrastructure, once again, in the public realm, that will help attract the private investment that we need to see these catalyst projects move forward. It also came about as a result of the public input and community engagement efforts that we undertook to get people's feedback about what they would be looking for in a public space like that. And I think the plan really reflects something that will be unique to Hagerstown and give us sort of a clarion call to all of the creative class out there, which is what we call the young, millennial, entrepreneurial, artistic workforce that is the future of our economy, not only here in Hagerstown, but all over the place. And this link will eventually connect the farmers market, which is another catalyst project, through the University Plaza, through a city-owned building, and behind the district courthouse, continue across Antietam Street, through the Harold Mail property, and through the Housing Authority property, through John Barr's property and Ellsworth Electric, eventually dog-legging on Lee Street and down Summit and connect to City Park, our what I like to call our second unofficial arts and entertainment district in City Park. And what this will do is really allow us to have a pedestrian corridor, if you will, to build and grow around. It's often said, I hear it so many times, why don't you just shut down one of these streets and, you know, create something like Winchester has or Salisbury or name another city that has one of those pedestrian malls. Well, that would be great, except we are a much bigger city and we have all of how many state roads coming through downtown. So it's not easy to just shut down one of the streets. We do it for special events. And then, of course, we all know what the traffic is like after, during and after those events. So, you know, this, again, gives us another area to focus on investing not only in commercial and creative uses, but also for housing, which is another very important issue for me, and I think one that we will continue to focus on. This is a priority for me because as the mayor of Hagerstown, I get to make the sole appointment to the Hagerstown Housing Authority. I don't even have to consult my fine council colleagues for this approval. So by definition, this is an important issue for me, but it goes beyond just the Housing Authority. We have to have all of the stakeholders when it comes to housing at the table. So what I have proposed is to hold a housing summit, and the plan right now is for this to be held in June. I've already been meeting with an advisory group made up of some of these stakeholders, and we'll be having another meeting, I think, next week or the week after. And the focus is really on understanding who is doing what in the community when it comes to housing. So we're talking about bringing in realtors, bankers, builders, in addition to landlords, property owners, tenants, some of the major social service agencies and housing authorities that we have, not just in Hagerstown and Washington County, but even pulling in Berkeley County and Franklin County, since they are in our metropolitan statistical area, and we know that people don't always stay within their state boundaries. So looking at the big picture of what is going on with housing in our community, who is providing what services, really understanding that information. So information sharing is the first goal of that housing summit. The second goal is to really look at best practices. What is being done around the country to revitalize old neighborhoods? We have a huge challenge in our old and aging housing stock here in Hagerstown. Beautiful old homes. But unfortunately, many people who live in these old homes are in fixed incomes now. They may not have the means to adequately maintain them. So we have incentive programs to do those kinds of things and emergency repairs and low interest loans and things like that. But our resources are ever diminishing for those. So we need to look at best practices for acquiring those resources. But also, we have to address things like homelessness and subsidized housing and the best practices for how we can deconcentrate that without necessarily displacing poor people. I believe all of these things can be achieved, but I think it's best achieved, once again, if we engage the whole community in this process. And at the end, the third goal of this housing summit is to have a shared vision and an action plan moving forward, and that we really, the summit is just the beginning and not the end of this discussion. So housing is important. A couple other things I think we need to continue to focus on this year is the ongoing heroin problem that we have in our community. It's something that we cannot afford to ignore. It really affects every demographic in our community, every neighborhood. So many families are affected by either opioid abuse or heroin abuse. We see all the time news reports about people overdosing. So it really is time for us to come together as a community, really address the issue, understand once again, what are the best practices around the country for addressing this issue. It really is unprecedented to have really the epidemic we have with heroin. So I know that there are efforts undergoing currently, and I pledge that the city will remain actively involved in helping to address that problem, those problems. A couple of other things that I think we can continue to work on in partnership with the Board of Education and the county is Winter Street Elementary School. You might know that this year Winter Street will close after, I think it's 123 years of actively serving the community. And it really is a shame because it's our really our only, besides Bester Elementary School, really our only neighborhood school where all the children walk. Nobody rides a bus currently, I don't think. Maybe one bus. But it will be a shame to lose that as an educational asset to the community. So what I am proposing is that we work with the Board of Education, the county, other service providers to really make it an interagency children and family center where we can continue to support the educational needs of the children in the community, but also of the adults to offer things like adult literacy or English language learning, job skills, those kinds of things, so that it, once again, can continue to be an asset to the community for education. Last but not least, in terms of what I'm proposing that we seriously consider looking at investing serious amounts of money into the stadium that we currently have. I know that this has been a sore subject of conversation in our community, especially in the last 4 years. However, it is a conversation we've been having now for decades. So I think it is one that I am proposing that we take action on to make a reality. I think we have a precedent now where we have the Hagerstown Suns paying rent when before they had not paid rent. So we know that they are able to make a lease payment. They paid $35,000 for the past 2 years. In our 2-year lease extension that the council just approved, they will be paying $35,000 a year again. But the difference is now the council has dedicated this money to go into improvements at Municipal Stadium. So just so everyone understands, every year the Nationals send a letter to the Suns and they say, here's all the things that are deficient about the facility that you're currently leased into. They send the list to the city and we do all the things that we can do. The couple things that they talk about, which are more big ticket items, we have not done. The big lump out in left field, it's like legendary now in minor league baseball that everybody, it's like they come to Municipal Stadium just to see the hump in outfield now. So fixing that would require tearing down the outfield wall, taking out whatever creates that big hump, probably a big lump of limestone, and then regrading and rebuilding the wall. It's probably a $500,000 investment just for that particular fix. That's just one example. The real issue there is that we have a liability. It's a facility that is not something we can all be proud of. But it does have historic value. It has had baseball being played in that facility for the last 80 or so years. You can see from the video, we have a long tradition of hosting professional baseball here in Hagerstown. It's one that we can be proud of and something we actually use to market for getting visitors to come here to Hagerstown. It's one more feather in our cap when we're trying to compete for those tourist dollars. And quite honestly, one that other communities not too far away would love to have, like Gettysburg or Winchester or other communities. But we have a stadium. And so the question is, what are we going to do with the stadium we have? And currently, one of the other big liabilities in that facility is the stormwater. It's on two sides. We have one marsh run that runs from City Park to Antietam Creek that has a constant flow. And then, of course, Town Run that runs from the dual highway, basically, all the way down the third baseline. It's pretty much dry unless there's a big storm. And when there's a big storm, we all know what happens. The whole stadium floods like it's one big stormwater management pond. So what I'm proposing is that we try to approach this in a different way, that we bring together the stakeholders, as we have been doing, including the Hagerstown Suns, whoever owns it at the time. But we need to bring those partners together including the state, and let's come up with a solution that's best for the community. We already own the stadium we have. We have property just to the west of that in Hager Park, the Hagerstown Light Department. So let's look at the assets that we have. Let's look at what we currently have that are liabilities, and let's turn the liabilities into assets. I think with a smart approach, with people coming to the table for real committed partnerships, that we can make this happen and not have it be a huge financial burden to the city of Hagerstown. So how do we do it? Well, we could do a couple things. One, we could look at where the hotel motel tax money is going. And currently we know there's about $2 million coming in every year in that fund. It was originally intended to go to a stadium. But I don't think it's going to be reasonable to ask the county commissioners to say, well, let's just go back to the drawing board and redistribute all the money that you've been distributing all these years. That would be putting them in a tough position. So let's set a baseline. Let's call it a couple years ago. Whatever the income for that fund was at that point, let's take any additional money, any increase in that fund over time, because we are selling more rooms and we're building more hotels. So the fund continues to increase, even though the rate is still 6%. And we can use, again, the excess in that fund to finance some of these projects. We could look at a small fee of $1 or $2 per night. Instead of increasing the tax and the room tax rate, which is still other people's money, the hoteliers, I think, will be more amenable to it, because even if they raise their rates for the night, they're not increasing the overall cost by more if we were to increase the tax rate. So a small fee, again, you can imagine if we sell 500,000 room nights a year, $1 or $2 per night added on to each hotel stay, there's a significant amount of funding for these kinds of projects. So let's get back to the original intent of what the hotel motel tax was for. Again, the city and the county, the state, we can all come together. But let's look at the stadium as a stormwater management project as well. Once again, we have to take these liabilities and turn them into assets. I hear us compared to Frederick all the time. Why don't you be like more like Frederick? Well, the lesson from Frederick is turning liabilities into assets. And so they took a creek that flooded out the downtown in Frederick in the 1970s. They spent more than $50 million of public money in creating a flood control system and a public amenity on the top, and really were able to jumpstart their economic growth in downtown because of that. So there are other ways that we can improve connecting downtown with the stadium we have, because it is not that far, through improved transportation, working with the county to have the county commuter do sort of a downtown circulator and get people to and from major points right outside the downtown back into the center city. And the interesting thing that I find in the conversation about the stadium is that 20 years ago when we were talking about it, we were talking about which interstate are we going to build it on. And this time around, in the more recent conversation, we're looking at where in our sustainable community area can we build it, somewhere closer into the center of our city. So I think that's a positive change in terms of how the debate has gone. But it has been a fracturous issue, and I think it doesn't need to be one. But I do think it is an issue we should act on. And again, the key there is we have to have a team that wants to be here and wants to be a strong partner. So once again, this is what I call my 2020 vision. Let's go after this low-hanging fruit. We can make all of these catalyst projects a reality. We're connecting all the various assets we have in our downtown with our beautiful city park. Soon we will have a completed multi-use path from City Park all the way down to the stadium along Marsh Run. We will have, hopefully, a new stadium, which, by the way, is not just for professional baseball, but a facility that can host all kinds of gatherings in the community and really be an asset, once again, we can be proud of. We have opportunities at the old hospital site with a commemorative park celebrating our Civil War heritage. Once again, trying to capitalize on the tourism that we know is so popular and one of the driving forces in our economic growth. So again, my goal is to stay focused and stay positive. And I think continuing our strong partnerships and working together, engaging the community, we can make all of these things come into reality. And I'd like to leave everybody with a quote that I have become so fond of recently. It reminds me a lot of what I think we can do here in Hagerstown. So by G.K. Chesterton, and he says, "Men did not love Rome because she was great. She was great because men had loved her." So let's all show our love for Hagerstown and keep the momentum going. And thanks again for being here. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have. Thank you. We're not going to have people fill out cards. We're just, if you would like to ask a question or make a comment, please feel free. Yes, sir.
I was thinking about the hospital area. Mm-hmm. Are you doing anything with that particular part over there?
Yes, so in the city center plan, the idea is to have a hotel conference center combined or connected with a commemorative park. So where we're starting is with the park. And the idea is that the main part of the old hospital site, where the main building stood, that would be a Civil War historic park. Apparently that was where cannons were stationed during the Civil War, so there is some actual Civil War heritage. So the idea is we would make the terrain just like it was using historical documents. And by the way, our staff have already come up with a plan and a strategy for bringing in various partners to help make this project come to fruition with little city investment, by the way. So I think there's a lot of potential there for really celebrating our Civil War heritage, drawing in more tourists, and then, you know, the hotel and conference center is much more higher fruit up on the tree, I guess you could say. But if we make all these other investments and the momentum keeps going, then it will look more and more attractive to people in that industry. Any others? And if you feel too nervous, I will stick around, so feel free and I'll be glad to talk with everyone as long as the library will let us stay here. Yes, Caitlin.
Real quick, the quote that you mentioned at the end resonates with me as a lifelong Hagerstown citizen and now teaching in South High Public School. And I used to talk a lot to my kids to get them involved in their community when you guys had Engage Hagerstown on the website and the Facebook site. I'm just wondering if anything from that has come to fruition or if that's going to be used more in the future.
That's a great question. I can't speak off the top of my head of what things have come out of Engage Hagerstown that have actually become a reality. I don't know if any staff want to chime in, they can. But I think the goal is to always be more present online. Our website is undergoing a major overhaul, and it's always been my common complaint. I don't know where Aaron is we don't have a mobile-friendly website at all, and everybody's on mobile phones now, so we're a little behind the curve on that. But you know, for instance, in terms of access and transparency and engagement, you know, I'm really proud that as soon as I took office, I went to our staff and said, how come our videos aren't on the internet, or our videos of our meetings? And so immediately we started posting them on YouTube right after the meetings were over, as soon as we could get it uploaded onto the internet. Well, now our ingenious staff have figured out a way to live stream on YouTube. So now you can, from the comfort of your own home, live stream. I think we had 90 people view our first live streamed video at the end of January. So we know that people want to tune in, they want to get engaged, and so we definitely are going to stay committed to giving people the platforms that keep them engaged. Yes, ma'am.
A lot of cities are having difficulty with finances.
Mm-hmm.
What is the financial situation of Hagerstown?
The financial situation is very strong. As you may have recalled from the video, our finance staff did win an award for their budgeting and accounting. One of the great things that we've been blessed with has been strong city management, so that no matter who's occupying the elected offices, we have a
an even keel when it comes to our economic status. We always have a balanced budget. We're required to, according to our charter. The city administrator every year presents a balanced budget to the council, and then the council has to approve it by a certain time. We have healthy reserves in terms of our fund balance. We keep healthy reserves at or above the recommended levels of the Government Finance Officers Association. So I would say that our financial situation is very strong in terms of how we balance the budget. Where I think we're weak is that we have a very tenuous assessable base. I think it's starting to head back in the right direction, but for the past couple cycles, we've seen a decline in the overall values of our properties. So I think one of the things that we've all of us on the mayor and council have stayed focused on is what can we do to support and increase our assessable base? So whether it's removing blight and addressing blighting influences, addressing issues with rental properties where we have owners that are absent and could not, or aren't as, I'm trying to be nice.
Diligent.
Yeah, that aren't as in diligent and invested in the community and trying to make them more accountable to the community. You know, those are all things, investing in the infrastructure that increases accessibility and interest in the city. Those are all things that I think are supporting and helping to increase our accessible base. So financially, we are doing good in terms of having a balanced budget, having healthy reserves, not having, too much debt. But where I think we still need to work is on our accessible base and the strength and the value of our properties. Anyone else? Yes, Brian.
You spoke of the multi-use trail proposing from City Park to Municipal Stadium.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, I haven't read anything about the plan, is mm-hmm. that going to encompass some kind of redo, if you will, of the Memorial Boulevard?
Well, you'll be happy to know that we actually have gotten approval from CSX to put a tunnel. We tried to go for an at-grade crossing with the railroad that goes across Memorial there. But I don't know if you know this, railroads have a lot of power. And they write a lot of rules in Congress. And so one of the rules is that if for every at-grade crossing you open, you must close three at-grade crossings. We had, I think, two or so close in the city with the Eastern Boulevard and Frederick. But they weren't going for that at-grade crossing there. So we did get approval, however, just recently for a tunnel, and we got grant money from the state for transportation alternatives in order to help us pay for it. One of the things I hope you noticed throughout that video was that we are very grateful and have used, as much as we can, grant money from the state and federal government. So, the Park Circle project, everybody says, how can you pay for all those fancy bricks? You know, well, first of all, they're not bricks. It's really just painted, stamped asphalt. So it's a lot cheaper than it really looks, which is nice. They did a good job. But the vast majority, I think 90% of it was paid for with grant money. And the idea in that particular project was to reduce impervious surface. So we got stormwater management grant money for that project. So I'll thank our staff and give them a lot of the credit for chasing down these opportunities to help fund the priorities that the mayor and council are identifying.
Can I do a follow-up?
Sure.
What is the difference in the water management between the tunnel and what's there now on Memorial Boulevard
That's a good question and one that the engineers will have to answer. They're good drainage, I think, is the answer there. Yeah, I'm sure that will be part of what they're figuring out. Yes, sir.
I'm a student at Hagerstown Community College. I actually saw you recently.
Yes, indeed.
And you spoke about getting on a commuter to run later because last bus is 4:45.
Mm-hmm.
Some students don't let out until like 9:30. Mm-hmm. So is that a conversation you're trying to bring up, or are there plans set out?
Well, I think overall, you bring up a very good point. His question was about transportation. He's a student at Hagerstown Community College, and depending on what time you get out of class, there's not always transportation that will bring you back from Hagerstown Community College to your neighborhood or anywhere even near your neighborhood. And he's not the first person to bring this up to me. So I think what we need to do really is sit down with the county and look at transportation overall to see how the transportation network jives with people's needs. I don't know the last time the county commuter engaged the community to see, if they're actually serving the needs of the community. But I think that will be a good conversation to engage in. And it also brings up a good point that there's no reason that Hagerstown Community College couldn't be a partner in some of the expansion of our educational footprint in downtown to better serve the needs of the citizens here, especially in the center city. Pastor Stan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You mentioned One Street School, and I appreciate your vision for that. Is there any active conversations going on with the county and the board at present, or is that more of your vision?
Not that I am aware of. I'm putting that out there as sort of a proposal to be considered by everybody. There's nothing written in stone at this point. It is. I'm hoping that it will be a conversation that's done in public, since it is currently a public asset.
But if there's any way to help that, let us know.
Thank you. Janet.
I'm sorry, I came in a little bit late.
You're going to have to serve detention, Janet.
I know, but I'm running late.
That's okay. Thank you for being here.
What I wanted to ask, I came in when you were talking about HUD public housing, and I wondered if you were aware of the webinar that was held. I attended a webinar last Friday at the Housing Authority that was put on by HUD and the Department of Indian Affairs about doing community gardens. At Housing Authority projects. And also the featured speaker from Master Gardeners was John Tomfeld, who is the head of the Maryland Master Gardener Program. And it was there were a couple projects they were talking about in Milwaukee, which is also the home of Will Allen in urban agriculture. So there's lots of possibilities for doing community gardens. Looking into that, I have one I'm working on now at Frederick Manor with the Boys and Girls Club. And so there's lots of partnerships there for actually doing, growing food right on in the Housing Authority property and hiring people. They hire people to be coordinators of that, and it builds community, and you can, of course, connect it with the farmers market here in Hagerstown, too, and bringing affordable, healthy food to the inner city. So I just didn't know if you were aware of that.
I was not aware of the webinar, but I think those are brilliant ideas.
I will be getting the transcript from it, so I can make a copy available to you, and I'm going to go into and talk to Delaney's office about that, too.
So great.
There can be
more partnerships.
Yes.
And I think what the success of our current community garden has demonstrated that there is interest in that in the community. And I think working with the Housing Authority to really engage that population in particular, and the children especially, is really important to promote healthy eating and active lifestyles. So
connect it with the agricultural programs too.
Sure.
For students in Steve Frame's program that are living at the
Well, thank you for your leadership on that topic, Janet.
You're welcome.
Yes, ma'am.
In Section 8 apartments that don't want to, are not interested in becoming a part of the community. And I hear it all the time, and I hear from people that they want to get out of the city. And it worries me. Mm-hmm. I'm very concerned about the trend that we're seeing, particularly in the north end of town and the historic areas.
Sure. Well, I think, you talked about the mindset of the council. As I mentioned before, I think this council in particular has been laser focused on maintaining property values in our neighborhoods. And we've done that in several different ways. Section 8 is a federal housing program
There are rules and regulations. You cannot discriminate. In fact, every year or every 5 years, there's an analysis of impediments to fair housing, and we're basically judged on whether or not we're living up to the tenets of fair housing law. So I think it's important for people to know we can't say no Section 8 housing in this area or that area. And any landlord can accept a Section 8 voucher. So I think in that we have to look at what is driving landlords to accept these vouchers. We've traditionally had a lopsided homeowner versus rental ratio. We've always had about 60% renter, 40% ownership, whereas in most of the country it's the exact opposite. So home ownership is not a new issue for Hagerstown, but you know, we mentioned the home ownership incentives. I mean, those are funds that are starting to be exhausted, but I think a lot of people don't know about them. So just getting out there with what programs are around to incentivize home ownership is important. I think your question about, you know, the will of people to live in town, I mean, you know, some people just don't like change. And so when different people move in the neighborhood or change starts to happen, you know, that can scare people, and I get that. Crime is a real issue anywhere it happens, no matter what neighborhood it's in. So our commitment is to make sure we have clean and safe neighborhoods in all parts of the city. One of the biggest things I think that's hurting our neighborhoods are these blighted properties, many of which are caused from foreclosure issues, where we can't identify a property owner to take responsibility for the property. So where a lot of these are private properties and should be maintained by the private property owner, the city is having to step in. Now we're looking at how can we abate these properties, spend city tax revenue, tax dollars to abate these issues so that they don't continue to have a deteriorating effect on our neighborhoods. So I think the mindset of this council, as far as I'm concerned, is very focused on the issue that you're bringing up. Again, finding a way to deconcentrate poverty without necessarily displacing people. I mean, the idea is if you're poor, you shouldn't have to only live in a certain neighborhood, that you should be able to take that Section 8 voucher and go to any neighborhood. And that's the idea behind fair housing. So everybody deserves safe and clean neighborhoods. Yes, ma'am.
I want to follow up on what she said.
Sure.
Really one of the main reasons I came myself. Now, when they started the Affordable Care Act, I did that initiative. And I've worked in insurance, and I transferred here originally from Philadelphia as a manager at FedEx. So when I came here, I had a very high income. And finally bought a house. I lived outside the city, and they gave me this credit, and I bought a house in the West End. Had I known, I would not have moved there. I spent about $200,000 for this house, and I've lost $60,000 value. To my surprise, people that I have interviewed, a lot of people for the health care, had lived here long. They moved here. Yes, what was the reason they moved here? Because what was it? They were looking for cheap housing. They were looking for nonprofits to support them, okay? I could probably have done a statistical study on that myself to show the correlation between the type of people that are coming into Hagerstown, okay, and the issues that we're having are becoming more problematic. The problem is not fair housing, but I don't want someone living next door to me like I do now that is in Section 8, is doing drugs outside, that's urinating in front of the house, who has overdosed one person 3 times on heroin, things that I've seen, okay? Mm-hmm. That, and I'm very a bold type of person, and will come to you and say, why do you have trash in front of your house? What will a Section 8 person say? And this is not a generalization, because I do it all the time. I walk 5 miles or more every day in Hagerstown, all through neighborhoods, through back alleys. Where they say, it's not my property, it's not my responsibility.
Sure.
Yet, this is your trash, this is your cigarette butts that you've thrown out the door. It's not my trash.
Right.
So, I have a serious concern. I'm getting to the point where I want to just get out of Hagerstown because I've dealt with a lot of nonprofits here. I've never been in a town before where I can eat every day and never have to go shopping. So many places, Community Action Council, I had an office there, and a lot of the other churches, I can tell you every place and go every day and eat somewhere and get groceries and never have to spend money. Okay? And so there is a certain mentality here where the people that are in Section 8, they don't care. They've got guys moving in there, and I can just like my house next door. He doesn't work, but he's got time to sell drugs. I call the city. I call the liaison person they hired and trained to work with Section 8. Okay? And every time I call the cops, I mean, I think I know Rebecca and all the cops by name. Nothing has happened.
That's right.
Nothing has happened. And the fact is, I walk down the street and see trash all over the place. And I'm not talking about houses that are in Fort Hood. Okay, I'm talking about houses that are owned by somebody. So why is there a mattress sitting outside? Okay, day one that mattress is out there, somebody should be fining that person. And I've always called code enforcement. Why is there a television set outside? Where is the person that owns these properties? If you have a multiple property, I went down a Sunday, I went walking with my husband, this one house going downtown on West Washington, there are about 30 bags of trash outside. 30. It's near that liquor store as you go down. Now, if you have a large place like that, a property, you need to have a dumpster. Okay, where I come from Philadelphia, they have row houses there. You didn't have people leaving their trash cans outside. You put your trash through the house. So I don't understand why it is that you gotta have people that leave trash outside, and not only do they leave it outside, they've got trash in the streets, they've got trash in the front of their house, they've got trash in the back of their house.
They're not held accountable.
Right.
Well, you sort of addressed a lot of things there, so I don't really know where to start. I definitely hear the frustration and anger that you're expressing as an investor in your neighborhood. And I think what I hear you saying is that you're trying to lead by example, by being a good neighbor and showing people what it means to have pride in your neighborhood, regardless of what you look like or what neighborhood you live in or whether you're renting or owning. And I hear that you say you're kind of getting tired of that, that it's hard to be constantly trying to lead by example. But I hope that you will remain a beacon of hope, let's say, in your community, and don't give up. Listen, I paid way more for my house than I should have 10 years ago. And that's really one of the things that compelled me to run for office, too, that I want to see the value of my own home stay the same as it was 10 years ago or get back to where it was 10 years ago. And you'll be happy to know that this council has been addressing those issues. I know it's not nearly as timely as you would like it to, but for instance, just tonight we introduced ordinances to change our trash and refuse ordinances to address some of those very things that you're talking about in terms of storage of trash and what kinds of containers you can store it in and where it should be. To address the issue of so many units needing particular trash storage, whether it's a dumpster or an enclosure or something on site out of the public view. So those are just a couple of things to address what you're talking about. But it is not something that is off of our radar. The issue with the concentration of nonprofits is something we keep bringing up, and we've been engaging the nonprofit community. It's not something that is easily talked about because everybody who's in that business feels like they're doing something good. But it's, once again, a lot of the issue is everybody knowing what everybody's doing and, you know, finding out if people are abusing the system, so to speak. You know, how do you deal with that? How do you address it? It's not just a city issue. And to be quite honest, when we talk about it, some of the response is, well, you know, you're just beating up poor people and that problem doesn't really exist. But time and again, we come to forums like this and we hear from citizens that this is what they're hearing. So, you know, it is an issue that we will continue to address, and I appreciate you speaking up and showing up here tonight. Yes, sir.
I have a question that's somewhat related to that.
Okay.
The city here was doing a study of the correlation between Section 8 housing crime in the community. In other words, did Section 8 residents increase the level of crime in the community, or is there no correlation?
I'm not aware of any of that data. There may be research out there, but I am not aware of it. Yes, ma'am.
You've talked a lot about communication and PR tonight. Mm-hmm. I think probably something that was developed a long time ago, I haven't seen one recently, is a booklet that informs mm-hmm. people, you know, where is there a park, where is the police station, difference between county and city housing, just something practical you could look at, and all these things that you showed on your...
That's a good question. The question is,
we don't have one.
Is there like a central map or information center that says where all the resources are?
You just mm-hmm. didn't know where to send people to go to a food bank, or mm-hmm. you didn't know what the cultural opportunities are. I mean, mm-hmm. it covers everything.
Sure.
I think that would help get the word out more to residents.
What the assets are that we have. Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Any other questions? Yes.
I wanted to follow up with that meeting that we had for the city market earlier this year.
Mm-hmm.
It was really a very upbeat meeting, and there were a lot of ideas thrown out. I'm mm-hmm. wondering if anything that came about with that yet, as far as reorganization of the city market?
Sure. We did put out an RFP, and the deadline to submit a proposal was February 1st, and we received one proposal. That proposal did not meet the requirements or expectations that we had planned. So basically, we're going to go back to the drawing board and figure out another plan. I think part of the issue is perhaps reaching out to current market operators and finding out, you know, getting some feedback from them on what our RFP looks like. You know, apparently many people came and took a tour when city staff organized a tour for potential interested parties. And there were several people who showed up for the tour, but they didn't submit a proposal. So we want to hear feedback from them on what, if anything, kept them from moving forward with that. But the bottom line is that the current state of the farmers market is not acceptable. It can be so much more of a catalyst and an asset to the city. It's currently completely underutilized, in my opinion. So we're not giving up. I don't see it as a failure. It's just we're going to go back to the drawing board and continue to look at how we can improve that asset.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
I read in the paper a while ago that the Smithsburg Reservoir is in a dangerous condition.
Yeah. Well, part of that is how the story was reported, quite frankly. But that has been an ongoing issue with the Edgemont Reservoir out in Smithsburg. The issue is that there's some subsidence around the spillway. So there's some seepage coming out from underneath the concrete there and through the dam. This has been going on for years. The engineers have been monitoring it. They keep the water level 6 feet below the regular level so that there's really no imminent danger to people. But the idea is that if it were to be full, it could be dangerous. But the bottom line is it will never get to that point because we won't let it. So the question before the council is really how and in what way do we want to invest in that aspect of our water system? I personally think that it was visionary of our forefathers to acquire that land and to create that source of water. Obviously, all of our water currently is coming from the Potomac River. The Brickner water plant in Smithsburg is shut down because it's not up to standards, current standards. So just the water plant itself would need investment, but to keep and maintain the reservoir would take even more amount of investment. So it's a matter of making it a priority and then funding it. But our utilities have been keeping up with infrastructure improvements in the water system and wastewater system, mainly due to requirements set forth by the state and the federal governments and the different standards that they have. But there is no imminent danger to anybody, but it's certainly an issue that has to be addressed. Hi, Dot.
As you know, I'm running for city council.
Yes, I do know.
And I have quite a few concerns, and I'd like to mention two of them. Don't you think it's time that the city and the county do something to help the Dolman Museum find a place to live? I think they should be in the Arts District. because their history will bring a lot of tourism to Hagerstown. I don't know if Alicia will agree with me. And the second is Just Looking Gallery. I met the owners about 20 years ago and been to some of their showings. She brings in a lot of the elite from Baltimore, Washington, and Virginia to purchase the art from her showings.
Indeed she does.
What is the city doing to help her? These people coming in, we should be doing something to get them to enjoy Hagerstown, to spend money in our restaurants. And I never hear anybody talking about Just Looking Gallery.
Well, I'm very familiar. Just Looking was just at their 21st anniversary celebration last weekend. Eileen and her partner, who passed away last year, purchased the building. They have some improvements, and I've talked with her about some of the programs that the city offers to help her with that. But quite frankly, she hasn't asked the city for help. She has been included in the Taste of the Arts event that goes on. But I've encouraged her to reach out if she does need assistance. I also think she can be an integral part of the art, cultural art trail that we're building. She'd be interested, she told me last weekend, of having a mural on the back of her building. So how cool would it be to have these all these artistic buildings in downtown Hagerstown? So I think there's definitely opportunity to help her be more visible in the community, because it is a very well-kept secret. I was just talking with somebody earlier about Just Looking. In fact, somebody's here from Just Looking Gallery tonight.
Sam.
I was going to say Sarah. I knew it was an S. So it is a great gallery. I encourage everybody to look. Go to Just Looking. It's at 20 Summit Avenue.
40.
I'm sorry, 40. 40 Summit Avenue. You can't miss it. It's between the courthouse and the Dagmar. The other question was about the Dolman Museum. I had actually just talked with Alicia before last weekend about looking at a city property. I have a particular place in mind that I think it's city owned, is highly visible, it's accessible, and right now the space that I'm thinking about is currently underutilized. So I think there is time and space. Now, I'll say they came to the city a few years ago and asked for $143,000 a year for 3 years. And I think even as a council person, you would probably have to say, we can't really afford that. Their challenge is, in order to get grant money from traditional museum funding sources, you have to be operating with so many hours a week. And that's been their big challenge, is getting that regular operating time to be able to establish their presence as an operation and then to access more funds. So I think the city is definitely willing to help. If the county would be a partner, that would be great. And I agree that it would be well placed in the Arts and Entertainment District. Any other questions? Any other council candidates want to say anything? Council members? I'm just egging. Yes, Brian.
Kind of a follow-up to the Smithsburg water question. I noticed on a recent water report that I got the amount of fluoridation in the city water versus the Smithsburg water. Who decides on that? Because Smithsburg apparently doesn't have any fluoride added to the water, and Hagerstown does. It has an NA. I don't know who, I mean, I realize you're not an expert on it, but I don't know who the contact will decide whether it's a county representative or a city representative or an unbiased report.
I'm pretty sure, and again, I would defer to staff on this, but I'm pretty sure Smithsburg has the same water as Hagerstown. Go ahead, Kristen.
They do, but they are the operators of distribution. So in other words, just like Williamsport, Smithsburg, Conestown, all three get their water from the city. So the base water, the treated potable water is from the city, but they monitor, maintain, and operate the distribution side of it. So we generate it, they distribute it. Therefore, they would be largely responsible for the monitoring processes and reporting, like the daily monitoring reports and the CCR, the consumer confidence reports they submitted to the state each year, and then they determine where. The levels of testing, and they test 30 or 60 chemicals, just like we do in Myersville, And depending on the type of system, depends on which ones they track, and then it depends on
where they sample.
Where you sample, as it applies. So, you know, if you're getting that water, you know, six houses from its entry point, that's your sampling spot. You're going to have a different level of reading than you are 10 miles from that sampling spot. And, you know, it's just the degradation of the chemical within the water as it's distributed or sits within the line.
So the answer to his question is contact Smithsburg. If that's where your water is.
Any other? I get my water from there, but I noticed that it has a non-active.
Oh, they have a different on the report, right.
Higher concentration of fluoride is so much higher. That's
gotcha.
Why it's not applicable.
Right. All right, any other questions or comments? Yes,
may
go ahead.
I compliment you on being so well informed.
Oh, well, thank you. I try to be as well informed as possible. I always like to say, if I don't know about it, I can't do anything about it. So that's why I'm always looking for stakeholder feedback from community input to help drive our decision making. I think it's very valuable. But thank you for your kind words. And thanks again, everybody, for being here tonight.